This is the video for Lab 5 on separations and analysis. We'll look at the data and report pages. In chemistry, separations and analysis are pretty common. We're always interested in separating mixtures, identifying what's there, and so these are common techniques that we'll be looking at. Let's begin with the pre-lab review page. Question number one is always concerning safety alerts. And when you answer this question, you'll want to review the text and review the lab manual and look for the triangle icons. Question number two is on disposal directions. Look for the garbage can icons. And the rest of these questions are pretty descriptive in the pre-lab review. I don't think you'll have any trouble with them. So let's look at the data and report pages. There we are. This experiment deals with paper chromatography, where you'll be using a piece of paper to separate a mixture of ions. And the ions are placed near the bottom of the paper. The paper is then put into a chamber with a solvent in the bottom. And as the solvent climbs the paper, it carries the ions with it. And they separate according to their solubility in the traveling solvent, or the mobile phase, we call it. And we'll be separating iron, cobalt, and copper ions. And when the chromatogram is finished, that is to say, when the solvent has reached the top, it's removed from the chamber. You have a way of visualizing the ions, where they've moved on the paper. And then you'll measure the distance that these ions have progressed. And I just put down some typical numbers here. When you record these numbers, keep in mind that you want to record them to the tenth. So I've got 5.1 and so forth. And we record not only those three ions, but then you'll record a mixture of the three ions. So in other words, you should get three spots. Then you'll have an unknown that you place on the chromatogram as well and separate the component ions. So in the unknown, it could be that maybe your unknown only has one component and you'd only see one spot, only have one distance to measure. Or in this case, I've recorded two distances to the tenth. And if you had three unknowns, three ions in your unknown, then you'd have three distances to record. The mobile phase is again the solvent that climbs the paper and carries the ions with it. Typically, it moves close to the top of the paper, and you'd want to record its distance in tenths as well. Let's look at the other side here, the column that's labeled report. And now you'll take those distances that the ions have traveled, and you'll calculate the RF value. RF is equal to the distance that the ion migrates, or the spot, over the distance that the mobile phase has migrated. So my calculation, 5.1, the distance of iron ion over the distance that the mobile phase traveled, 6.2, would give me an RF value of 0.82. Remember always that my numbers are typically hypothetical, so you wouldn't want to copy down these numbers. Just use them as a guide for significant figures and for manipulation. For example, these numbers on the left are to the tenth, but there's two numbers there, so I need two significant figures when I calculate the RF value. The grader will look to see that you've expressed RF values to the hundredth. And each of these will be to the hundredth, unless you had something that migrated less than one. For example, the cobalt ion I put down as 0.5. When I calculate the RF value, it's 0.08, only one significant figure when I express it to the hundredth. But in general, the grader will look to see that you've got two significant figures over there. Here's where I've recorded the RF values for the mixture. 0.82, well, hey, that must be the iron ion. 0.61 must be the copper. 0.1, well, it's just about the same as cobalt, so it is the cobalt ion. Down below, here are two values now for the unknown. Two ions are present, 0.82. Hey, my unknown must have iron in it, the Fe3 plus. 0.1, my unknown must have the cobalt ion. And going down the table just a little bit further, it asks for the ID number of the unknown. Remember that there are different versions of the labs, and so it's okay to work together with a friend, but you always want to use your own data when you get ready to submit your reports, because data will vary, and you wouldn't want to get penalized by using someone else's data. Your ID number is the ChemWeb number. When you log into ChemWeb, says your student lab number is such and such and gives you a four-digit number. That's what you'd put right there. Here then, the identity of the two ions according to my data. Let's look at part B. Part B is on sublimation. Sublimation occurs when a solid goes directly to the vapor state without passing through the liquid state. Freeze-drying would be an example of sublimation, for example. And in this experiment, we've got a mixture of calcium carbonate and ammonium chloride. One of these two is going to sublime. That is, when we heat the sample, it'll go into the vapor, the solid will go into the vapor state, then positioned above the sample is a cool watch glass, and the vapor will deposit as crystals on the bottom of that watch glass. We can collect the solid. Here's a blank for the collected solid. And test the solid to see what it is. And the test that we're going to use is the behavior when HCl was added. So we'd add HCl to solid calcium carbonate. And note what happens. Remember, you're looking for color changes, a gas evolution, or the formation of a solid that you didn't have before. Those are the three characteristics that are most commonly indicative of a chemical change. I'll test the calcium carbonate that way, the ammonium chloride, and record if any bubbles or fizzing occur. The mixture, well, up here, one of these two is going to give some bubbles, so the mixture should give some fizzing or bubbles also. And the collected solid, the big question is, does it give fizzing and bubbles or not? Which of these two is it like? And that's what you'll be, the conclusion that you'll be drawing over here on the right-hand side. The identity of the collected solid that's sublimed. Right here, you'll put calcium carbonate or ammonium chloride. It's one of the two, not both. And the explanation simply is that the collected solid gave identical behavior when HCl was added to it. Part C is on solubility. We're testing, in this case, calcium carbonate and a new substance, copper sulfate. And one of these two is soluble in water. One of these two is not soluble in water. And we'll separate them based upon their solubility. We're going to collect the insoluble solid in a funnel, and the filtrate is that water-soluble substance that passes through the funnel. And here's the mixture. And we're going to test now these substances, and we'll test the mixture, the filtrate, and the insoluble solid from the funnel. two chemical tests. We're going to add HCl and we'll add NH3. And here in the first case, note any bubbles or fizzing that occurs. One of these two is going to bubble or fizz. And be sure and record that. Well, the mixture then should bubble or fizz. And the big question is, does the solid from the funnel bubble or fizz? And you'll use that information to conclude which of these two the solid in the funnel is. Over here, we'll be adding NH3. And this time, it produces a color change. So note any color changes. And you'll be testing the filtrate and see what color is produced and whether it correlates with the copper sulfate or the calcium carbonate. Use that information to identify the water-soluble substance, the filtrate, and the insoluble solid that collected in the funnel. And of course, the explanation would be that the behavior of the insoluble solid acted like whatever it is that you identified it as, and the same with the filtrate, that its behavior acted like the other one. Let's look at the questions at the end of the experiment. According to the chromatogram in part A, which of the three ions you separated had the strongest affinity for the paper's stationary phase? Well, that means that it didn't travel very far if it had a strong affinity for the paper. Those substances that had a strong affinity for the mobile phase would move up the paper a long ways. But here we're looking for the substance that moved the shortest distance. Number two, student collects some chromatographic data, calculates an RF value of 1.4. Which of these A, B, or C is most likely correct? Well, keep in mind the formula for RF. How is it calculated? That'll help you answer number two. Number three is pretty straightforward. Number four, look at your data in part B. That'll help you quite a bit. And number five, number six, these aren't hard questions, but remember filtrate, that's the water-soluble substance that passed through. It's not the insoluble solid. And I hope you've had fun with this experiment. Remember that you can email me or call me at any time.